Hello, this is Dr. Mahalakshmi IP, reader from the Department of Oral Medicine and Radiology, and this class is for third year and final years. Oral Medicine and Radiology. We'll talk about pigmented lesions of oral mucosa. Before we start, we'll see what is lesion. A lesion is a structurally and morphologically altered tissue. Coming to pigmented lesions of oral mucosa. We saw what is lesion. Now we'll see what is pigment. A pigment is any organic or inorganic coloring substance. A pigmented lesion can be defined as an area of altered coloration of the oral mucosa, either because of physiologic or pathologic process. I repeat, a pigmented lesion can be defined as an area of altered coloration of the oral mucosa, either because of physiologic or pathologic process. There are different color or different pigmentations we come across in the oral cavity. Those are blue, brown, and black discolorations constitute the pigmented lesions of oral mucosa. And such color changes can be attributed to the deposition of either endogenous or exogenous pigmentation. It is broadly classified as endogenous pigments and exogenous pigments. Endogenous pigmentations are the one which is inside the body. The discoloration is the discoloration due to pigments present within the body, whereas exogenous is from outside the body. For endogenous examples are hemoglobin, hemosiderin, bilirubin, etc., melanin, etc. For exogenous, amalgam tattoo, graphite tattoo, metal poisonings, these are the causes for exogenous pigmentation. Although there are many biochemical substances and metabolic products that are pigmented, only a few become deposited in the oral soft tissues, although some accumulate in developing dentin during odontogenesis. Those are bilirubin pigment, porphyrins, and hemosiderin. It is broadly classified as endogenous pigmentation and exogenous pigmentation, and there is one more also, miscellaneous. Under endogenous, depending upon the pigment and the color, the disease process is classified. Hemoglobin, the lesion appears blue or red or purple. The disease process are varices, hemangioma, Kaposi's sarcoma, angiosarcoma, hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia. Because of hemosiderin pigment, the lesion appears brown in color. The disease process includes ecchymosis, petechiae, thrombosed varices, hemorrhagic mucosal hemochromatosis. Because of melanin pigment, we have brown, black, or gray color lesions that includes melanotic macule, nevus, melanoma, basilar melanosis with incontinence. Coming to the exogenous pigmentation of oral mucosa. The source may be, there are many metals here. Mainly metals we can see here, amalgam, graphite, lead, mercury, or bismuth, chromogenic bacteria. The colors may be gray-black. Most of them appears gray-black. Chromogenic bacteria also appears in green in color. The disease process are tattoo, ingestion of paint or medicines because of this lead, mercury, bismuth get incorporated in the body. Because of chromogenic bacteria, the lesion may appear. The superficial colonization of bacteria leads to black, brown, or green color lesions. That is one of the example for exogenous pigmentation. Before this, we'll see what are the other miscellaneous lesions that may be associated with oral mucosal lesions. I have told you about exogenous and endogenous. And there is one more miscellaneous lesions that may be associated with oral mucosal discoloration. Those are pyogenic granuloma, peripheral ossifying fibroma, peripheral giant cell granuloma, mucosal, mucoepidermoid carcinoma, acinic cell carcinoma, lymphoma, etc. I repeat, the other miscellaneous lesions are pyogenic granuloma, peripheral ossifying fibroma, which appears red or blue in color, peripheral giant cell granuloma, again it appears red or blue in color, mucosal, which appears blue in color, mucoepidermoid carcinoma, which appears blue in color. These are few examples for other than these exogenous and endogenous pigmentations in the oral cavity. There is one more clinical classification of oral pigmentation. This is clinically when the patient comes to you with a lesion, how we will classify. These are classified under color, focal, diffuse, and multifocal. Focal is where exact border of the lesion can be made. In diffuse, you can't make out the exact borders. Whereas multifocal, the same lesion is there in multiple sites. So depending upon the color, blue or purple lesion, the patient comes with. If it is a focal lesion, it's a varix or hemangioma. If it is diffuse, it may be hemangioma again. Under multifocal, we have Kaposi's sarcoma, hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia. Brown color lesions includes melanotic macule, nevus, melanoma under focal lesions. Under diffuse, we have ecchymosis, melanoma, drug-induced pigmentation, hairy tongue. Under multifocal, we have physiologic pigmentation, neurofibromatosis, hemochromatosis, lichen planus, Addison disease, drug-induced pigmentation, pure Chagre syndrome, Petechiae. Gray or black lesions include amalgam tattoo, graphite tattoo, nevus, melanoma under focal lesions. Again, under diffuse also, we have amalgam tattoo, melanoma, and hairy tongue. And heavy metal injection pigmentation is seen in multifocal lesions. This is according to Burkitt's. Blue or purple vascular lesions, blue, brown melanotic lesions. Depending upon the color, he has classified blue or purple vascular lesions, brown melanotic lesions, brown heme-associated lesions, gray or black pigmentations. Under blue purple vascular lesions, we have hemangioma, varix, angiosarcoma, Kaposi's sarcoma, hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia. Under brown melanotic lesions, epilis, nevocellular nevus, malignant melanoma, drug-induced melanosis, physiologic pigmentation, cafe olite pigmentation, smoker's melanosis, pigmented lichen planus, endocrinopathic pigmentation, HIV oral melanosis, huge Chagre syndrome. Under brown heme-associated lesions, ecchymosis, Petechiae, hemochromatosis. Gray-black pigmentations includes amalgam tattoo, graphite tattoo, hairy tongue, pigmentation related to heavy metal ingestion. Till now we saw two types or different types of classification of oral pigmentation. What are the causes for such lesions? Causes of pigmented oral lesions include physiologic pigmentation, it may be due to racial or oral melanotic macule. Genetic causes, there are many genetic diseases which cause pigmentation in the oral cavity, that includes Peutz Jeghers syndrome, Reckling-Hansen disease, Albright syndrome, Carney syndrome. Some hormonal imbalances also cause pigmentation. That includes Addison's disease, chalasma. Systemic diseases like chronic lung diseases also cause pigmentation in the oral cavity. Drug therapy, foreign bodies, heavy metal exposure, reactive causes, smoker's melanosis, nevi, melanoma, HIV infection, idiopathic origin. These are the causes of pigmentation in oral cavity. Coming to the lesions as such, hemangioma. Hemangiomas are blue or purple vascular lesions presenting as a proliferation of vascular channels or tumor-like hematomas. Hemangiomas of head and neck appear a few weeks after birth and grow rapidly. They are characterized by endothelial hyperplasia. In most of the cases, they undergo involution. In adults, particularly in elderly persons, benign vascular proliferations are generally varicosities. The hemangiomas of childhood are found on skin, in the scalp, and within the connective tissue of mucous membranes. Approximately 85% of childhood onset hemangiomas spontaneously regress after puberty. See how the lesion appears. in the oral cavity, whether it is sometimes it appears blue, sometimes it appears red. That is because of the, depending upon the depth of the lesion, depending on the depth of the vascular proliferation within the oral submucosa, the lesion harbors the lesion may harbor vessel close to the overlying epithelium that appears red. The one which is superficial lesion appears red, and the one which is deeper appears blue in color. Some lesions, they occur within the muscles, so-called intramuscular hemangiomas, they fail to show any surface discoloration. I repeat, some lesions will not show any pigmentation or color because they are present within the muscle and they are called intramuscular hemangiomas. They fail to show any surface discoloration. How these hemangiomas in the oral cavity appear? They appear as a raised and nodular. Some may be flat, macular and diffuse, particularly on the facial skin, where they are referred to as port Weinsteins. Again, this port Weinstein is a short note. This is how we describe hemangiomas: raised, nodular. Nodule is a lesion, solid raised lesion, which is more than 1 centimeter in size. They are called nodules. So hemangioma is a nodular lesion. Sometimes it appears flat, sometimes it is macular. Macular means changing the color of the lesion. So now it is showing the red, reddish blue or purple color. So it's a macular lesion, and diffuse. Diffuse where you can't make out the exact border of the lesion. On the, if the lesion appears on the skin like this, then they are referred to as port Weinsteins. Most oral hemangiomas are located on the tongue, where they are multinodular and bluish red. The lip mucosa is another common site for hemangiomas in children. It's also classified. Hemangiomas can also be classified as, there are superficial and deep, small and large. Depending upon, hemangiomas may be classified, this is one classification. It can also be classified as capillary or cavernous type. The former is superficial and the latter is deeper. Capillary hemangiomas are superficial hemangiomas, whereas cavernous one is deeper hemangiomas. Dioscopy test, this is one of the chairside investigation done to know the true diagnose hemangioma. Hemangioma can be diagnosed with the dioscopy test, which usually blanch on pressure. Test is performed by pressing the glass lid gently on the lesion. If the lesion blanches, and when you remove the slide, if it again fills up with the blood, then it is a positive for hemangiomas. Positive dioscopy test is indicated by blanching and suggests blood is present within vascular spaces and displaced out of the lesion by application of the pressure. This is again a short note, dioscopy test. Coming to Sturge-Weber syndrome, again this is Viva question and a short note again. Sturge-Weber syndrome is a neurocutaneous disorder characterized by three features. Port Weinstein, I already told you, see how it on the skin, how the hemangioma is appearing. Here you can appreciate hemangioma on right half of the face. This is Port Weinstein, cutaneous facial angioma. Seizures and other neurologic complications associated with angioma of the left meningitis and glaucoma. These are the three features of Sturge-Weber syndrome. Glaucoma is increased pressure within the eyeball. So I repeat, Sturge-Weber syndrome includes Port Weinstein, seizures and glaucoma. There is also a radiological feature for Sturge-Weber syndrome. Those are called tremblant calcification. In skull radiograph, This is the skull radiograph showing tramline calcifications. Vascular lesions occur in the brain as well as on the facial skin. They also appear in the brain and as well as on the skin. Skull radiography may disclose a vessel wall calcification. You can see here a vessel wall calcifications that yield bilamellar radio-opaque tracts. Here we can appreciate bilamellar radio-opaque tracts referred to as tramline calcification. Again, tramline calcification is a viva question. Coming to the treatment of hemangioma, since many hemangiomas spontaneously involve during teenage years, treatment may be withheld in children. Patients who require treatment can undergo conventional surgery, laser surgery, or cryosurgery. Larger lesions that extend into muscles are more difficult to eradicate surgically, and sclerosing agents such as 1% sodium tetra-D-cell sulfate may be administered by intralesional injection. If the lesion is big, it is difficult to operate surgically. In such conditions, 1% sodium tetra-D-cell sulfate is injected. Once it is injected, the lesion will shrink, will reduce in size. Then it will be easy to remove surgically. Other than these hemangiomas, there are other vascular malformations. They are called as AV malformations. These AV malformations may be clinically apparent at birth, grow slow proportional to the growth of the child. Whereas hemangiomas, they involute with the age. Whereas AV malformation, they grow with the age. And they never involute. They may be classified depending on the vessel type involved or flow types, arterial and arteriovenous, capillary or venous. These are the types of AV malformation. They may be classified depending upon the vessel type involved or flow types, arterial and arteriovenous, capillary or venous type. These are the AV malformation which looks similar to hemangioma, but it grows with the age, whereas hemangiomas involute as we attain puberty. Coming to the next lesion, varices. The focal dilatation of vein or a group of venules is known as varices. It occurs in elderly persons, primarily on the lower lip. Appears as blue, red or purple, and the surface mucosa is often lobulated or nodular. You can appreciate in the picture a nodular growth with the lobulations. You can see many lobulations here. If you see the picture, it will be easy to describe the lesion for you people. So it appears as a blue or red or purple in color with the nodular and lobulated. Pathologic dilatations of veins or venules are varices or varicosities. Pathologic dilatation of veins are called varicosities. Okay. In oral cavity, it is less common compared to other parts of the body where we can see many varicose veins on the legs in many elderly patients. And if it happens in the oral cavity, it is on the ventral part of the tongue. You can see here, ventral part of the tongue. 3 to 5 varicosities become progressively prominent with age. Thus, lingual varicosities are encountered in elderly individuals. 3 to 4 veins, pathologic dilatations of veins combine to form these varicosities. Lingual varicosities appear as a tortuous, serpentine, blue, red, and purple elevations that course over the ventrolateral surface of the tongue with extension anteriorly. They are painless and are not subject to rupture and hemorrhage. So, as it is painless and they don't rupture, no treatment is required. Coming to the treatment, the lesion can be excised or removed by other surgical methods, including electrosurgery and cryosurgery. Again, intralesional injection of 1% sodium tetradiazole sulfate is also effective in such lesions. Next is angiosarcoma. Angio means, as we all know, blood vessels. Sarcoma is tumor of connective tissue. So it is a tumor of connective tissue as malignant vascular neoplasms. Distinct from Kaposi sarcoma are not related to human immunodeficiency virus. See, angiosarcoma is different from Kaposi sarcoma as seen in HIV infection. So although the oral cavity is an extremely rare site for such tumors, those that will appear red, blue or purple. Angiosarcomas are less common in oral cavity compared to other parts of the body. They are rapidly proliferative and therefore present as a nodular tumors. You can see the nodule here. They arise from the blood and lymph vessels. They have a very poor prognosis. And they are treated by radical excision of the lesion. Coming to the Kaposi sarcoma, this tumor or Kaposi sarcoma is associated with HIV infection. A tumor of putative vascular origin, which was rarely encountered in the oral cavity prior to 1983. The classic form generally appeared in two distinct clinical stages. In elderly people, in the oral mucosa and on the skin of the lower extremities, whereas in children, it was in lymph nodes. The former is the classic form of originally described by Maurice Kaposi and is an indolent tumor with slowly progressive growth. How the lesion appears in the oral cavity, Kaposi sarcoma, this is multifocal lesion, which appears as red, blue or purple in color, mostly seen on the heart palate. You can see here, I told you multifocal means it is on the many sides. It is on many sides, okay? So Kaposi sarcoma does not show a great tendency for metastasis. The oral and cutaneous tumors are considered to be multifocal origin rather than metastasis from a distant primary tumor. These are all primary only, it's not a metastatic tumor. These are multifocal in origin. The oral tumors appear red, blue, and purple, and the heart palate is the favored site. The skin tumors tend to localize in the dorsal aspect of feet and great toe. The oral lesions show a predilection for the posterior heart palate, and they also begin as flat red nodules of variable size and irregular configuration. These lesions increase in size to become nodular growth, and some will involve the entire palate protruding below the plane of occlusion. The facial gingiva is the second most favored site for Kaposi sarcoma. Surgical excision is not usually attended as severe hemorrhage, but electrocautery is recommended either as a primary form of surgery or as a coagulative hemostatic adjunct to the conventional excision. Intralesional injection of 1% sodium tetradiazole sulfate will result in necrosis of the lesion. Next is hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia. You can see many pinpoint hemorrhagic points on the tongue and on lips. It's a genetically transmitted disease inherited as an autosomal dominant trait, characterized by multiple round or oval purple papules. What are papules? Papules are solid rose lesion, which is less than 1 centimeter in size. So these appear as a oval purple papules measuring less than 0.5 centimeter in diameter. There may be more than 100 such purple papules on the vermilion border of the lip. and mucosal surfaces of lip as well as on the tongue and buccal mucosa. The facial skin and neck are also known. There is no treatment of the disease for the disease. If the patient would like to have the telangiectasis areas removed for cosmetic reasons, electrocautery is advised. So this is about hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia. Coming to brown melanotic lesions, till now we saw red-purple lesions. Coming to brown melanotic lesions, in that we have epilis. The common cutaneous freckle or epilis represents an increase in melanin pigment synthesis by basal layer melanocytes without an increase in the number of melanocytes. On the skin, this increased melanogenesis can be attributed to actinic exposure. Epilites can therefore be encountered on the vermilion border of lip, the lower lip being the favored site since it tends to receive orally, lesions are oval or irregular in outline. See, it's oval or irregular in outline, brown in color, sometimes black also, and tend to occur on the lower lip, gingiva, palate, and buccal mucosa. This is the first part of pigmented lesion. Next session, we'll continue the exogenous pigmentation of whole cavity. Thank you.